Assalamu alaikum and welcome to another episode of Making a House a Home with myself, Sana Araji, and our guest, Fahima Muhammad, a qualified life coach and an NLP practitioner. Assalamu alaikum, Fahima.
Alaikum salam.
Now, today we're going to be carrying on talking about Ramadan and discussing family structure and community and how that fits into Ramadan. Can you explain how family structure and community is important during Ramadan?
Well, let's just remind ourselves first about observing fast and how it's, you know, prescribed upon us and how we have to become pious in Surah Baqarah. You know, it does actually highlight that. And Fatima Zahra alayhi salam says that fasting was made obligatory, you know, as a means of establishing sincerity. Now, when we hear these sort of, you know, hadith and, you know, surahs and, you know, these statements, we sometimes just overlook it in a general sense. But I want to bring it back to the actual home, the actual family, the actual structure and community. And also, we should know that there's Imam Sajjad states in his Risala that, and the right of fasting is that you should know it is a covering, that it is set upon your tongue, your hearing, your sight, you know, your tummy, and it's protecting you from the fire. Mm-hmm. Also, it is quoted that, you know, obviously with fasting, Imam Sadiq alayhi salam has said that Allah has made fasting obligatory, not just for the rich and not just for the poor, but for us to, you know, be as equals. So when we take all of these sort of hadith and examples that I've just highlighted, and you bring it back to the home, mm-hmm. I'd like to sort of like say that we receive a lot of information and instruction generally about Ramadan as to what is the significance and what we should do and what we shouldn't do and what nullifies Ramadan, which is, you know, very, very crucial. It's very, a vital information. But at the same time, we need to know the full human condition and the experience that we need to sort of be aware of during this month.
Yes.
So for example, when we have, you know, increase in our ibadah and we increase in our reading Quran, in our fasting and worship, extra prayers, charity, the heightened consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then obviously we are, you know, thinking that, you know, we are doing what we need to do for Ramadan. But we also have a responsibility for our families. We have a responsibility for our homes, for society, and for outside the home.
Yeah.
And that's really important. Mm-hmm. Islam is for us, but for us to share and for us to integrate and for us to learn as well as teach.
Yeah.
For us to be influenced by the good and to influence others. So we have struggles, you know, as believing Muslims, you know, having community around us, you know, basically as Muslims, you know, with all the challenges. But let's just consider the challenges and the tests that are faced, for example, the reverts.
Yeah, of course.
We need to consider that as Muslims already. We have maybe friends or we might see someone in the mosque all the time. But how much are we actually, you know, opening ourselves to that person, to that type of community? Because, you know, everyone's segregated. Mm. Unfortunately, it's not just in Ramadan, but generally our mosques, our centres, people that we associate with, the cliques, the friendships. It's very much our own kind, our own culture. It's not Muslim as a ummah.
Yeah.
It's not even humanity, people, because the only way sometimes you can influence is to actually go and integrate into outside your own religion, outside your own culture, for you to learn and for you to teach.
Yes, of course, yeah.
So family structure and community is important and vital information and awareness that we need to have. And this time of month is a perfect opportunity to sort of, you know, open yourselves up in your mind, in your way of thinking and believing, in your habits, how you live, you know, in your home, and how do you take that outside?
Yeah, of course. I mean, Ramadan can be a very lonely time for converts or reverts, mm-hmm. and you know, not all of them were blessed to be brought up in a Muslim household where they've seen Ramadan every month. They've observed the fast as a family, as a community, and they've had that beautiful spiritual closeness.
Yes.
So in a way, you know, could we do more to bring them into our homes, as in allow them to be involved so that they can feel part of the family? Because a lot of the time, you know, it's mainly them that has converted and their parents are still non-Muslims, or their siblings are non-Muslims, and they're lonely and they're kind of isolated.
Of course, it's definitely an issue that we need to be aware of and raise ourselves.
Yeah,
I know the mosques and the centers, they have, you know, circles and societies for reverts, and they might mix between them, but they themselves want to be open into and integrate into the communities around them.
Yeah,
but they can't do that and invite themselves. So everyone around who is already Muslim, who is already, you know, in the inner community, need to take upon that responsibility to take them and invite them home, to give them that, you know, few days of knowing what it's like to be in a family, in a Muslim community. Whether or not they're with their families or not, some of them, you know, are still living, like you said, some of them are alone completely because they've actually taken themselves out of even their own families and communities. So this is something that we do not raise enough, and we do not give awareness as to what is it that we can do as individuals, as families, as a community, and what more can we do?
Yeah.
So like I said, you know, we need to pray, fast, give charity. But what about, you know, the things that outside, you know, blessing and ibadah is more than just your obligatory. It is so much more. And that's what we need to take from this holy month.
Yeah.
You know, giving someone a helping hand, inviting them, even them giving them, offering just water. Our Rasul, you know, peace be upon him and his family, said even that basic, you know, water that's given in iftar for somebody is so much blessing. So to invite someone, to give them an experience, imagine.
And the first experiences are very important, because if someone is perhaps considering becoming Muslim, and they might visit a mosque, and just that moment of stepping in, the environment, the feeling that they get, it could create either a positive or a negative. And the best time is Ramadan, because it's where everyone gathers up.
Absolutely.
So the mosques do have a role and a responsibility to all Muslims of all faiths. And I feel like that is slightly neglected in some cases. Do you feel that?
I'm not sure about it being neglected, but what I can say is that when it comes to integration, I think the responsibility should be on us, because we only go to the same places all the time. And that's not a learning for us and our new generations.
Okay.
I know we go for convenience a lot of the time because it's close to us, but then why not make it every week we go to a different center, whether it's the Hoja, whether it's the Iranian, whether it's the Iraqi, whichever it may be.
Yeah.
Why don't we learn in that way?
It's a great idea, actually.
You know, do it that way. And that's when you can see more. That's when you can learn more and open up. Put yourself out there, even if it doesn't come to you.
Yeah, definitely.
And I think that's a better way of looking at life. And actually, because we shouldn't just be Muslims united by culture and country. We have to be united more so as humanity. You know, looking at humans as one, as being as one. So if our religion would only be the way it is because of the way it was spread in history, it didn't just stay in the Middle East.
Yeah.
It went much further around the world. That's why it's so widely spread. But now we are even more enclosed. We're so scared of, you know, letting our children play with another sect or another culture or another background. That's how we've become in this modern day and age. If your home is solid, with good foundations, good learning, good values and beliefs, you can let that child go out and they will learn openly as to what is right and wrong, because that's what they've taken from the house. But to keep them caged and closed and only in the same setting, in the same situations, all the time seeing the same faces, that's not learning. That's not opening up your mind. That's not opening up anything. It's same again. It's just, you know, remaining in this bubble.
Yeah, we're limiting ourselves, really.
It's very limiting.
Yeah.
So going to different mosques, you know, there are programs everywhere. Yeah. And they're in languages now which we all speak in English. So we're very fortunate. There's absolutely no excuse, especially in London. So, you know, take that time to experience that. And with reverts as well, I find that we need to sort of be a little bit more, you know, sincere as to what they're going through. Because it's not just about experiencing iftar, it's about the family unit.
Yeah.
But our own family unit needs to be solid. There's no point in you fasting as well. And there's no point in you praying and giving charity when you are at home grumpy and you're not even giving that attention and the time to your own family.
Yeah.
So those things are really important.
Yeah, definitely.
And then also we have others that we need to consider, which are widows, single parents. That's a very testing time for them.
Yeah.
And this is the reality, unfortunately, in our society today. We have people that have been separated. So how do they celebrate? How do they benefit? How do they live? You know, because families, you know, are together a lot of the times during the holy month. So what is the structure there?
Yeah.
Especially when there's children involved.
Yeah, single parents, it must be incredibly difficult because...
It's incredibly difficult.
You know, perhaps they've had negative stereotypes towards them. Maybe they've been outcasted from their community and they're left on their own. And that could maybe make them go to, you know, away from Islam.
Absolutely.
And so it's so important that we, you know, we try and stick together as a community really to help, even if we see our neighbour who is a single parent or perhaps a friend that we know.
Yes.
You know, we should maybe invite them. What you know, what bad would that do? Invite them, bring them to your house, let them see, be around you.
That's true. I mean, you raised a very important point again by saying that, you know, people, when they are in the situation, automatically they are outcasted because of the situation they're in. A lot of the times it's not their fault.
Yeah.
And don't forget, we all live in glass houses and anything can happen to us at any time. So, you know, the more we lend, the more we reach out, the more we give and open our doors, inshallah, then, you know, less bad and less anything will come to out to us. When you're like, okay, no, well, she's divorced now, we can't really have her round, or he's, you know, a single person now, we cannot invite them anymore, and that family is now, you know, not a family anymore. You know, we need to open our minds. Let's just talk about the reality of today. This is what we're doing.
Yeah.
And we call ourselves Muslims and we're fasting.
Yeah.
And then we have this sort of, you know, way of thinking and believing and behaving. So we need to really open up Islam and the teachings and the meanings and how we live day to day. This is the whole point of the show, making a house a home, because it's daily challenges, daily routines, daily habits that we have created, the way in which our mind is, the way in which we are being as humans to ourselves, to our families, to where we look at other people. And all these stereotypes exist, all these cliches, all of these things do it because we create it. Doesn't mean if it exists, we have to conform. We can be the one that breaks those barriers.
Yeah.
We can be the one that actually makes the difference. And it only takes one person. So, you know what, I'm just going to carry on like normal. And I'm going to still invite that person, or I'm still going to have them as a friend, or I'm still going to be, they're still going to be part of the community.
Yeah.
Regardless of their situation. And that is the difference that it makes to an individual.
Yeah.
And that's when you become a leader. That's when you become an influencer. That's when you become, you know, a legend in a way. Because you are creating something for generations that are watching. Your children and society and communities. But we don't do that, especially in our society and communities, especially amongst the Muslim Ummah.
Yeah.
It's very, very segregated, very, very much to their cliques, very much to their country and whatever language they speak in.
Within their comfort zone.
Within their comfort zone.
It's whatever, and they don't want to go out of that because it's safe and it's secure and they don't want to explore, but they're missing out by not exploring.
They're missing out.
And, you know, just one person, it could affect them and change their whole life around, and maybe their children and then their children's children. They don't, you don't realise the impact it could have on one individual until you do it. And I think we maybe tend to listen to what others think about us, or we're scared to be judged. But ultimately, we should just be scared to be judged by Allah.
Absolutely.
And that is our priority. And I think sometimes it's hard. Many people tend to forget because they're very well known within their community,
yes,
and they don't want to be seen in a negative way. I mean,
that is
you
so true. That is absolutely true. We are dictated and defined by other people and the so-called community and society that's around us. But how much harm is that actually doing for ourselves, for our future generations?
Yeah.
So Ramadan needs to be something that is reflection upon ourselves as to the way in which we think and live. Mm-hmm. And when it comes to our family structure and communities, we cannot be segregated anymore. You know, these sort of things that happen are so backward. This is what Islam is so much against. And mm-hmm. if we're doing that to our own kind, what hope is there for the future?
Yeah.
What hope? And if we want, you know, the outsiders outside our religion to look at us in a particular way, then we need to set those examples between us.
Mm.
We can't be brothers and sisters between us.
Yeah.
We say those words, brothers and sisters. What does that mean when we don't live it?
Yeah.
We don't show it to real brothers and sisters, let alone the ones outside the community.
Very true.
So that is something that needs to be considered.
Yeah.
And the other group of people I would say that we need to obviously also consider are the elderly.
Yeah.
They are very lonely because of the time of life that they're in and their stages. And they can still, you know, be invited in our mosques and our societies and communities to even give advice, to even give talks and lectures, so that they feel part of something still,
mm-hmm.
that they can actually, you know, advise, because the youth need that wisdom from the elderly.
Definitely.
We can learn so much. They are so useful, but we just forget them too. And that's very lonely times. And a lot of them may not be able physically, but if there's a way, you know, of doing it, it can be done.
Yeah.
You know, how Ramadan used to be and what little that we had that we used to still celebrate and appreciate and, you know, do things during this time and worship with so little.
Mm.
So that's the other thing that we need to consider. And when we invite the elderly, we can learn so much history.
Yes, very true.
And we can really, like, you know, appreciate what we have. And even we think in today's society with technology and with all these advancements that we're so ahead, but actually things were done a lot more cleverly before.
Yeah.
So, and community was a lot stronger before.
We have a lot to learn from them.
A lot
I think
to learn.
And we think that we don't need to listen, but actually from someone who is elderly, their life experience, the knowledge that they've gained throughout their life experience,
yes.
is much more than ours.
Absolutely.
So we can pick the things that are good and maybe use it, incorporate in our own lives and learn from the elderly. They have a lot to give within the community.
Well, you know, the spirituality and essence of Ramadan is so much more than you thinking about your food,
yeah.
and just thinking about your tiredness and just thinking about those long days and thinking about work and children and home. Because, you know, it's about people. That's what makes us connected, is
yeah.
people around us and inviting all types of people around us. Our homes shouldn't be with just one color. It should be all colors.
Yeah.
It should be a rainbow. Our community centers should be that too. And you can take that however you want. But seriously, you know, our religion is for everyone. And even if they're not practicing, even if they have no idea about religion,
yeah.
it should still be open.
Definitely, yeah.
So these are the things that we need to consider when it comes to family structure and communities. And we as individuals really need to take more responsibility about that.
Yeah.
And this, you know, speakers and the, you know, society, the community centers, they need to advise about this too. And open up people's minds about this so that we are aware of it. So when we see somebody, we don't have to be even friends with them. Just, you know, just sit next to them and, you know, just have a conversation.
Yeah.
What's your name? Where do you come from? What do you do? And there you go. There's a friendship there. And you can learn from each other. You can, you know, advise each other and you can have something different. And everyone has something to give. So don't underestimate anything. And your
yeah.
situation will never be the same. Just
okay.
remember that. So that's one way of always knowing that you have to be out there humble about whatever you are, whatever situation you're in, because that's going to make you inviting to somebody else.
Yeah. Well, you know, thank you very much, Fahima. I'm sure the viewers have learned. So inshallah, we'll be going to a break now, and inshallah, you'll take the information on board, and maybe during Ramadan, we can perhaps do something different and invite someone into our homes that we wouldn't normally invite. But inshallah, we'll come back to answering some questions from our dear viewers. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Ah, 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 ah
Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to the second part of making a house a home. Now we've been discussing family and family structures and community, and we have a few questions from our dear viewers. Now the first question I have for you, Fahima, is Mustafa, and he says he's a revert that's married with his own family, but he remembers when he was new to the religion and he found this time to be very lonely, even though the mosques did have classes for reverts and a few friends did invite him to break his fast. However, people in general are very much used to being with their own kind. So how can we change this, as I do not want to see the future generations conform in the same manner?
Yeah, I mean, at the same time, we cannot change other people's ways. So we need to basically start with ourselves. And even as a revert, now having your own family, you can be that change, and you can be the one that actually, you know, invite other people from all different cultures and sects and backgrounds, and at the same time, you know, show others. We need to take responsibility as Muslims generally, and it's really sad that we still don't. Year after year, decade after decade, generation after generation, we're still set in our own ways of when it was time in, you know, in Arabia, where everyone was like, you know, in their own sort of, you know, type of background with regards to their sect and which, you know, which sort of, you know, background and, you know, culture and tribe they were from. So that is very backward thinking, and I think it's time that we really need to reflect, and we need to take it an actual goal and to make it an outcome that this Ramadan we're going to set a goal, that we're going to find someone that is outside our community, that is outside the norm, and actually bring them home. So, you know, if that's what it takes, that's what it takes. And if each one of us that's listening, you know, makes that a priority, it can be done. And that's when you can just automatically, it'll be the norm. So it's you know, it's us as individuals taking that responsibility upon ourselves. And the enlightenment from that and the empowerment from that is just, you know, so dramatic. And we don't realize that when we do this, our children are watching. And that's so important. That's a learning in itself without any words being spoken, sitting amongst people from all different cultures and backgrounds, sharing and praying and eating together. And that's what it's all about. Not just the same faces with the same language and the same thoughts, you know, because even the conversations can be quite dead and boring. You know, this can bring out so much more elaboration on information and knowledge. Learning from a person's past and their journey. And that is teaching in your home. And you say you don't have time? Well, there you go. Invite someone that's not from yourself, you know, in the same way. And that alone is a lesson. So you want to change communities, you want to change generations, start by doing it yourself. And again, I advise, you know, that each Muslim, each person takes it upon themselves to actually do the same.
Would you say maybe perhaps as a, like, if a revert was to go to a mosque, they should perhaps try and push themselves to get involved, like, don't be scared?
That's the other way, of
break
course.
Through the barrier of fear and think, you know what, I'm entitled to be here, I'm a Muslim. I'm not going to allow anyone to intimidate me.
That's true.
And then build your way up in that way, whereas if everyone runs away because they're scared, no one's going to be going.
That's a very good point of looking at it too, because even if people are not inviting, you need to be the one that, you know, looks like you can be invited by putting yourself out there. You know, speaking about this even in one of the lectures and say, can I even have, you know, a space to talk for 5 minutes? And, you know, raising this awareness in one of the centers when there is, you know, one of the Ramadan, you know, series or whatever it may be in the mosque. So that people have that. So then that could be something, because a lot of people, it's also lack of knowledge. So they probably think, oh, they're taken care of, everything's fine. They don't really realize that actually, no, there's a lot of people out there that are lonely. And we're one of them. So whether it's even getting a group together in the mosque, it doesn't have to be in the homes, so that you get a group of people together, the regular, to come and, you know, be part of this group in the society, and then, you know, raise it in that way. So there's various ways of doing it. So yeah, that's a very good point.
Inshallah, yeah, that's a great advice. I mean, the second viewer we have is anonymous, and they say, I'm divorced. I'm a divorced woman with children, and Ramadan is a very testing time for my family. In my home, it is nice when I invite family and friends, but to receive the same in return is not usually extended because previously family have stopped others inviting me. How can I deal with the situation?
Well, that's lack of knowledge. That's lack of, you know, sort of way of being. Yes, when there's a divorce, when there's a separation, of course there's a separation of family and friends, but it doesn't mean that it goes to the extended. There's a lot of families that still mix. Remember, especially if there's children involved, they're still related in cousins, in relatives. And even as adults, you still have friendships within the other side that, you know, you're divorced from. And if people want to obstruct that, and if people want to segregate that, and then they want to, you know, cause barriers, then it's on them. Yeah. And at the same time, it just only highlights that they're the ones that have the issue. They have the psychological, you know, sort of like imbalance. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, obviously that person's probably intimidating, or that person, you know, just feels like, you know, they just want to keep that person apart for whatever reason. But that, again, is not living and being as a Muslim. Because things happen. Yes, you know, there are separation and there's divorce, and doesn't mean you have to come together as one. But there will be scenarios where you might still mix and, you know, mingle. But for you to go out there actively and say, I don't want that person in my space when I'm around, then what does that say about you? Just in a general setting, what does that say about you, let alone in an Islamic home, for you to be out there speaking that to somebody and, you know, causing that barrier, you know, creating a broken relationship or trying to break a relationship, a friendship. What is that? And that's one of the worst traits of a person.
Yeah.
You know, at the end of the day, it shouldn't matter who's there and who isn't there. Even if you don't want to have a conversation in friendship, just be civil and say salamu alaikum and be, you know, respectful.
Yeah.
You know, normally in these groups and settings, they are, you know, they're quite a few people. But you can still be in an environment where you're with somebody who is previously your family or relative, and because of divorce or separation, they're not your family anymore. Yeah. But if you want to cause more rift and more fuel to the fire, then it's only going to come and affect you anyways.
Yeah, definitely. And it could, you know, that would affect the mental state of the mother and then how she looks after her children. I mean, the impact,
they're not
it
even
rolls,
realizing
it
that.
Rolls over.
Of course. The main thing is that when you're stopping the adult, you're stopping the child that also is your relative.
Yeah, exactly.
So what is that? People don't see it in that
way. You're punishing the child.
You're punishing the child because of your own ego.
Yeah.
Whatever it may be, or your own issues, whatever. So that person needs to sort themselves out. But you as a single person, you keep inviting. You know, your doors are going to be open and Allah's going to open more doors for you. In fact, your life's going to be elevated even more so, because people who want to put you down, or, you know, press you, in a push you in a certain wall or keep you closed, you're going to be opened up even more.
Yeah.
And you're going to be in their faces even more. Whether they like it or not.
I know,
And that's what happens.
Would you say it's better not to retaliate? For example, if someone is being like that, you know, if us being human beings, we try to, you know, retaliate.
Question. Confront.
And we might confront them. Or we might think, you know what, if they're doing that to us, I'm going to do that similar thing to them. We should try and...
Let them be
and just think, you know what, we're doing this for the sake of Allah. We shouldn't care about if they want to be negative, they want to be like
this. I will pity that person who feels like that. Because only hurt people, only sad people, you know, are like that to other people. And they obviously have their own issues. So you pray for them. You know, that's the only way to rise above other people, is to always show goodness no matter what.
Yeah.
Positive comes out of it, no matter what.
Yeah,
and that's where your strength is. That's where your protection is. And only prayer will be able to give you that strength to do that.
Yes, definitely.
Prayer is your power.
Definitely.
So that's what you need to remember. And other people that want to put you down and, you know, seclude you and, you know, make your life even more worse than what it is, that's on them. They're being judged.
Yeah.
You know, you cannot control that. But you don't need to retaliate. You don't need to counter or confront. If the occasion's there and you feel you can speak about it, depending on the relationship, you can address it in a very civil way and a very respectful way. Maybe just to educate them. But most of the time, these people are doing it out of spite, out of their own ignorance. And they know anyways.
And be the better person,
and
I guess.
Be the better person, exactly.
Okay, that's great. And we have another question from Miriam, and she says, in our culture and societies, we tend to not mix as much. So how can we even integrate outside and teach others about Ramadan and its benefits, let alone that our religion represents unity amongst many other wonderful things?
Yes, again, we need to take responsibility ourselves. It's no point even looking and pointing fingers at anyone else and say they don't integrate. You yourself integrate. You yourself put yourself into centers that you wouldn't normally go to. Go to mosques that are outside your community and culture and that alone will get you being seen and heard, and then invite them to yours.
Yeah,
do it in that way. And, you know, like I mentioned before, you know, trying out different mosques in different areas and in a different week.
Yeah,
you know, that's a really great learning. It's an amazing learning. And like I said, you know, you make friends that way and then you call them to yours.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what you open up. And, you know, inshallah, one day we have a group of people that will just have a center called a center, regardless of its name, for where it comes from and which, you know, culture it, you know, belongs to, which, you know, background and which, you know, country or whatever it may be.
Yeah.
It's just there.
For everyone.
For everyone.
Yeah.
And inshallah, that's something that we should aspire to.
Inshallah, yeah, inshallah. And what about the idea of parents maybe getting involved with schools and informing them about Ramadan? So perhaps taking in food and say, and speaking to the class and saying, you know, it's for us Muslims, it's the month of fasting.
Yes.
And that will give others that are not Muslims or maybe Muslims within different sects an insight.
Absolutely.
Would you think that could be something?
That's a very good idea. I know a lot of people actually have spoken to me about this, where their children will take in like a project with regards to, you know, add it to their homework and, you know, discuss Ramadan.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's really, you know, at, you know, whatever age they are when they're children, it's really inspiring.
Yeah.
And they become proud.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's a learning and it's education for themselves and others. And when you're proud of what you're doing and you go out there presenting it, I think it's such an inspiring way of, you know, bringing out this blessed month
in, yeah.
And that's real integration. That's real way of, you know, making our religion, you know, open wider.
Yeah, exactly. And others will become more tolerant. They'll understand because you're not, you know, you have friends from all different religions and beliefs, and we're taught as Muslims to tolerate each other no matter where you're from. So if that's put from a young age into a child's mind, you know, they'll get used to that. I mean, there are people from the Jewish community who go into schools and they talk about their Jewish celebrations to the class. So they take it out and they take their time and they go into schools and they do that. And, you know, children will, especially my child, she'll come back and say, we've learned about Hanukkah or we've learned about this. So we as parents sometimes need to step up and
Absolutely.
Not expect everything to be done for us. I think, you know what, we have a role. Each of us has an individual role as a Muslim.
We have a role and we definitely have responsibility.
Yeah.
And we are accountable for it. And we're not just going to be questioned about the obligatory. We're going to be questioned about what's in between.
Yeah.
And that's what's going to really make you the person and, you know, create you into that, you know, that being that needs to be something special.
Definitely.
We want to be legends. We want to be, you know, creating a legacy. This is the way you do it. Not just through money and fame and fortune or the best job or the best profession. It's you influencing and being part of society in a wider sense.
Yes, definitely. And we want to constantly progress.
Yeah.
We don't want to stand still. We want Islam. We want the teachings of Ahlul Bayt to constantly keep going, going,
Absolutely.
Going and not coming to an end. But thank you very much for that insight. I mean, we've got one more viewer.
Sure.
And she is saying, Zina, sorry, our children do find it difficult to fast, especially when they attend school and they are the minority fasting. So how can we make this easier and appealing for them?
Well, as we discussed in the previous question, obviously,
you
know, it's like inviting it into the schools.
Yeah, exactly.
Educating others, because a lot of the time people also judge because of ignorance. So we need to sort of, you know, eradicate that and, you know, in sort of ignorance, you know, sort of do the opposite and, you know, give the education. And when our children are educating others, they themselves are being educated. So you say, go and speak to the schools about it. And yes, physically, it is demanding on a child. Again, you need to, you know, have a process where they are fasting and you need to create individual beings so that even though they're the only ones in their classroom that's fasting, you need to be there to support them as to how they can maneuver around that situation.
Yes.
Mm. You know, it doesn't mean that you have to be an Islamic school or you're going to have loads of Muslims there, because in this country, in this life, wherever you're going to be, you're going to be put in situations where you're going to be the only one standing out and you're going to have to be okay with that and take it upon yourself to be a leader for it and let the others want to question you and follow you, and you don't need to be, you know, afraid of it.
Yeah.
So that's a different outlook and that's a different way of looking at it. So I am doing this and this is why and this is my benefit. You know, I know a lot of people, they've told me that even some of their non-Muslim friends want to fast with them because it's something exciting.
Yeah, something new.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
How we can influence, especially with children.
Exactly. It's very true. I mean, we've now reached the end of the show. Thank you so much for
You're welcome.
For all your insight and information. I, again, have learned a lot and I'm sure the viewers have too. And I hope you've benefited from this episode. Inshallah, we'll be back next week with another episode of Making a House a Home. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.